Well, as you know, from time to time, I like to tell prison stories because I worked for 6 years in a men's maximum security prison in Huntingdon, Pennsylvania. These stories are not meant to have shock value or have some grandiose plot about violent criminals. What the stories are meant to be is this, is that when you work in prison with some of the hardest and toughest members of society, it really lets you see what the true, deeper, core important things are in the gospel and who Jesus Christ is and how we need to be his disciples and to follow him. And as you know, it was in prison that I discerned my calling to become a minister, so it's important to me. But as I work with these men in prison, they were violent criminals, drug addicts, a pretty rough crowd. They all had two things in common. The first thing is they all wanted to get out of jail. They didn't want to be there. And the second is they didn't want to come back to jail. But the problem is that in Pennsylvania, about 50% of inmates return to prison. So one in every two, they are released and then they come back. There's this cycle of what's called recidivism, of people that keep coming back to jail. And one of the things that I used to say to them is, what are you willing to give up in order to stay out of prison? And they would be a little bit confused by that and say, what do you mean giving up? And I'd say, well, you have a path, certain values or desires, and if you keep taking a path that is based on what you want, where you're the master of your own destiny, you will be in prison the rest of your life. You need to turn over a new leaf and to literally become a new person. And I had a strong focus on spirituality, and I said, you need to have a God-centered life where God is in control, not you. And there is a cost to that. There's a cost to God. God gave up his only son as a sacrifice to give the grace to everyone. But there's also a cost to you, and that is that you have to surrender your life and your will to God as you understand him. Well, unfortunately, most of them never got it, but the ones that did succeed, and I'm still friends with at least one inmate that I worked with 25 years ago who made that decision, who understood that he could only change by the grace of God, and that grace was costly because it cost God his only son, but it was also a costly grace for him to receive, that he had to surrender, confess his sin, and change in order to have freedom and a new life. Well, let's turn to our Old Testament text today. I've been following the lectionary readings, and last week we heard about Noah and the covenant that was sealed with the bow in the sky. Today we hear about Abraham, who was one of the great patriarchs. That's why we have prayers in the name of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And Abraham, the Abrahamic covenant, was one of the first and most important covenants in the Old Testament. What is it in simple terms? A covenant is an agreement between two parties. When people are married, they call that the covenant of marriage. And the thing that we have to remember about covenants with God is that God is not our equal. He is much more powerful and more faithful than any of us can be. And we can see in this covenant agreement that God has with Abraham, he was old. It says he was 99 years old, and he's promising to bless him with offspring that will populate most of the world. And even if we don't take this literally, we can see that being in a covenant with God is a way to assure us blessings from God. However, in any covenant, there's two sides to that agreement, and there are things that God expects. God, on his side, promised back in Exodus 7:7a, he said, I will take you as my people, and I will be your God. And in the covenant, God promises to be our God. But Jesus later, in the second covenant, the new covenant, the New Testament, tells the Jewish people that our end of the deal is simple. We have to love God with all our heart and all our soul and with all our mind and with all our strength, and we have to love our neighbor as ourselves. This is the foundation of our faith. Covenant relationships where God promises to be our God and bless us, but we have to do something to keep up our end of the covenant. Well, let's move on to the New Testament reading from Mark. As I mentioned in my prior sermons, Mark's gospel can be broken up into different sections. The first half or first part of the gospel is about miracles and healings and exorcism, where we see the great supernatural power, the divineness of Jesus Christ. And then there's a transition in chapter 8 where we see a focus on Jesus' suffering. And chapters 8 through 10, there's focus on being a disciple. And a disciple is someone who follows someone. They not only study them, but they follow them as a leader. Well, Jesus opens up in our text today, and he says that he must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. Now look at those last 8 words, be killed and after 3 days rise again. We've heard this story a million times, but to those people that would not have made sense. And they would have been confused, thinking, here's a man who can perform miracles and he's teaching with authority about the scriptures and he's saying that he will suffer and be rejected and then died. And they had no idea what he meant by saying to rise again. So Peter, who was just another person, and he was a fisherman, down-to-earth guy, who had in just a few verses earlier acknowledged that Jesus was the Messiah. He understood that Jesus was the Messiah, but he didn't understand this part about suffering, death, and resurrection. So Peter takes Jesus aside, and it says he rebuked Jesus for saying that. Now, that word rebuke is used in the New Testament when Jesus rebukes demons and tells them to be silent. And it's a rebuke is kind of like saying, shut up. Well, Jesus hears that and he is offended, even though Peter did it on the side. And he calls disciples over, and in front of the other disciples, he rebukes Peter. And he says to Peter, he says, get behind me, Satan. For you are setting your mind on the divine things, but not on human things. Now, wow, get behind me, Satan. That's rather harsh, I'd say. But Jesus knew what was at stake. He knew that he had a mission, that he would have to be rejected, suffer, die, and be resurrected. But people didn't yet understand that. So another way that we could look at what Jesus said to Peter, I'll put it in my own words, would be this. Attention, dark forces. I'm the one who is in control, and I will not give in to your temptation. Peter, you being a human being and not understanding, you have to remember there's a bigger spiritual plan and a greater mission than you can understand from a human and worldly perspective. And I think we are all like Peter in that sense, in that God has a bigger picture and a bigger mission, and we don't always understand that. And when we don't understand that, and when we are too self-centered about what's in it for me, we end up not fulfilling God's will and not participating in God's plan to provide salvation to people in this world. Jesus goes on and he says, if you want to become my followers, you have to deny yourselves and take up your cross and follow me. And we know what that means, to bear a cross, to bear a burden. What Jesus is telling these people is, if you want to be my disciple, if you want to follow me, you have to deny yourself, okay? You have to make sacrifices, not just financial sacrifices, but you have to deny having everything being centered around what you want in life and work towards understanding what I want. And you will also have to accept that as my disciple, as my follower, you're going to suffer and struggle just like me. And then he goes on after that and warns them that if they continue to live a life where it's just about what they want in this life, it would be a form of spiritual death or suicide. He says, for what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? And this really is at the root of the gospel. And what I think we need to look at here during Lent is we are looking at what it means to know who Jesus Christ is, and more importantly, to follow, to be disciples, to follow Jesus Christ. Well, let's go back to what Jesus said to Peter. He said, you're setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. And I think that we all struggle with that in this life. I know in my sermon last week, I was joking around with that quote from Oliver Wendell Holmes, that people can be so heavenly minded, they're no earthly good. But the flip side of that is we can be so caught up in what we do here materialistically and in this life that we forget to think about the divine or the godly perspective. Now, Jesus says to them in verse 31, he says, the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. So in that short verse, we see the pattern of what it is to live the life of Jesus Christ. And if we are going to follow him in our life, there has to be a parallel. And what is the plot line or the trajectory of that Jesus-style life? Suffering, rejection, death, and resurrection. And those are the components that I want all of you to focus on as we go through this Lenten season, as we read the scriptures each week here for these 5 Sundays of Lent. I want you to think about the suffering that Jesus underwent, and think about what suffering you have experienced in your life. I want you to think about how Jesus was rejected. Why was he rejected? Because he was speaking the truth and threatened people who were not committed to the truth and an honest relationship with God. And that's something for you to think about during Lent too. Are you in a position sometimes because of your faith that people are confronting you and rejecting you? And then death and resurrection. Well, I could say it's in February, and at this time of the year, usually at Country Meadows, we experience many deaths. And I know in this past year with the COVID pandemic, we have had more deaths than we usually had in the past. And death is probably the most difficult thing we ever have to accept in life. However, as Christians, we have to remember the two sides of the coin, death and resurrection. Now, we will not get to the resurrection until Holy Week, and in particular Easter, which is April 4th, 2021. And between now and then, we will be focusing on suffering and rejection. Then we will get to death and resurrection. Now, my sermon title today is talking about grace, discipleship, and the cost of grace. Now, I want to talk about that. Grace is God's unmerited benevolence towards us. Grace is a gift that God gives us good things, saves us, not because of what we've done or who we are, but because he loves us. It's unconditionally given to us. And one of the most difficult things, going back to working in the prison that I had to deal with, was this, is that people who had committed very violent crimes, I dealt with many people in there who had committed murder, some very heinous murders, and they said that they really struggled believing that God could forgive them. And I don't know how many of you listening today are thinking about things that you have done that you need God's forgiveness for. But for things that are big, that require big forgiveness, you would imagine that there would be a great cost associated with being able to give that forgiveness. And that's the whole point of Lent and Easter, is calculating the costs. The cost of our sin and how much pain sin has caused in our life, but also the great cost that God must pay to be able to reconcile us with Him so that we can be forgiven through Jesus Christ. And ultimately that cost, of course, will be Jesus' death on the cross. But there's also a cost that we can't get there without experiencing and feeling the pain and suffering of sin in our life. And going back to the prison, it was the inmates that did not acknowledge how wrong their decisions were, that did not acknowledge the pain that they caused other people and their crimes. Those were the people who couldn't change. And this is the paradox, is by embracing pain and suffering in our life, that prepares fertile ground for us to receive God's grace. And that's why it's costly. It costs pain on God's part of sacrificing His Son. It's costly on our part because we have the pain and suffering of acknowledging how wrong we are and how we need God to save us. Well, one of my favorite theologians from the 20th century was a German Lutheran martyr, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, and he talked about costly grace in this way. He said, "Costly grace is the gift which must be asked for, the door at which we must knock. It is costly because it calls us to follow. And it is grace because it calls us to follow Jesus Christ. It is costly because it costs a man's life. And it is grace because it gives a man the only true life. It is costly because it condemns sin. And grace because it justifies the sinner. Above all, it is costly because it cost God the life of His Son." So on this second Sunday of Lent, I want you to think about your need for God, for God's grace in Jesus Christ. And as we move through the Lenten season and towards Easter, I want you to think about, who is Jesus Christ? Not only who He is in history, but who He is to you and what Jesus does for you. Does He heal you? Does He forgive you? Does He accompany you in your struggles and suffering? And I want you to think over this Lenten season about what your relationship is with Jesus Christ and whether you appreciate what He has done for us with His suffering, with His being rejected, with His death and resurrection. And as you listen to all the scriptures that we read between now and Easter Sunday, I want you to reflect on these things and remember that the whole point of Lent and Easter is to realize that God's grace that saves us is costly to God and costly to us. Amen.